to the Silicon Nubian web channel. Today we're going to present another build video. This time we'll be building one of our favorite products or genres of computers to build, that being the home theater PC, or HTPC for short. What is an HTPC, you may ask? Well, it's a convergence product. It's a combination of hardware and specific software with the goal of presenting media in a very pleasing GUI. Okay, that's how I would define it. It's basically, in layman's terms, a place where you can dump all of your pictures, your videos, your audio, your music, your streaming services, and present it on your television or computer monitor, wrapped in a very pleasing graphic user interface. And that's what we plan to do today. The build we're going to do is a budget build. We've tried to keep the price as low as possible, partly from the client's request and partly just to show as a proof of concept that to build a modern home theater PC, you don't have to break the bank. In fact, the home theater PC can be one of the least expensive computer builds, even though at its heart it is a general purpose PC. This one will be running Linux, as our more previous builds have done as well, Linux Mint. Most likely XFCE version. We chose Mint because it uses the LTS, long-term support kernel from Ubuntu, which means that it will be supported up until 2019, which is one less thing to worry about from the client. There are frequent updates, the stability is fantastic. For our HTPC front-end software, we will be running Kodi, the latest release. And that has proven itself to be a fantastic and one of the more popular home theater PC GUIs. Not to take anything away from Plex Media Center, for example, but this build will run Kodi. Let's look at the components. We're starting out with a budget case. It's the Supercase DM318 Micro ATX half-height desktop case. Can't really call it a desktop, as you can mount it vertically, so you have the option of horizontal or vertical orientation. We've decided to go with the Haswell Rrefresh Intel Celeron G1840 processor. Some people might say, well, why didn't you use an APU? Well, there's no real defining difference with respect to home theater PC. But if you're looking towards future capabilities, we decided to go with the G1840. In the latest Intel drivers, they have unlocked QuickSync, which is their hardware acceleration modes in their Haswell and Haswell Rrefresh processors. And the Celeron G1840 will benefit from this. What that means is that 4K acceleration, for example, is done completely in hardware. Hardware accelerated, which means the CPU itself works very little to even decode 4K streams, which is great since everything's moving towards 4K. We also decided to go with an 1150 socket, 1150 Intel based processor for the clear upgrade path. At this point in time, AMD, the FM2 Plus socket is quite old, and we're just wondering what AMD is going to do next. I myself have an APU in my home theater PC. I have an older but generation, but still fantastic, A10 5850K. I love it, but that home theater PC is a couple years old now, and I'm going to keep it. It does exactly what I want, but for this one, we decided to use a more modern processor with a much more clear upgrade path. We have an old hard drive, Seagate hard drive, hanging around that we're going to use. Not much is going to be stored on this home theater PC per se. The user may want to dump a few videos or pictures or whatnot, but it's not critical. We have 4 gigs of DDR3 memory that we had lying around the office. We have an LG DVD burner. Some might ask, why didn't we go Blu-ray? Well, the issue with Blu-ray that we see is with the increasing dominance of streaming services, we find Blu-ray to be less and less of a desirable, or all optical formats actually, a desirable option, unless the user has a vested interest or a large investment in Blu-ray movies, and then we'd include one. This user does not. They have some DVD movies. They're more interested in using streaming services, so hence we went with a basic LG DVD drive, which is also a burner, just in case they want to burn something. For the motherboard, we went with the MSI H81M E34, which is a very basic H81 motherboard at the lower end of MSI's motherboard lineup. It basically has the check marks and all the boxes that we care for this build, and the price is right, keeping within the budget confines of this build. And the only thing that we're going to add to this setup would be a remote control, which I believe is around $30 to $35, to give a more immersive home theater experience, much like you would controlling your television from your couch or whatnot. We will be using a remote control with this, and we'll show you that unit later at the end of the build process. So let's get started. I want to welcome you in. I want to welcome you back to Silicon Nubian. And let's get started with this build, shall we? And let's put together this home theater PC together. All right. Okay, we've unboxed the case. And it's a nice looking case. If a little bit deep. It is a little deep, but it's okay. Let's see what's inside. The usual box of goodies. It's the stand for mounting it in a vertical position. Bag of screws. Speaker, which you don't see often nowadays. Rubber feet. Instructions, of course, power cable. We'll look inside. It's fairly well laid out. See, optical drive, hard drive, SSD if necessary, which the system will not have initially. The one thing about these cases is the power supply is not known to be the best, but I've ran a few of them, and as long as you run them well within their limits, they seem to function pretty adequately. 24-pin connector, a couple SATA, 80mm fan. We're going to gauge the noise of this fan when the system is built. One thing about a home theater PC is you want it as quiet as possible. At least that's how we like to build it here at Silicon Nubian. And we're going to continue on that trend. So now we're going to that's for to facilitate mounting. It pops up. Put in your drives, and then back down into place. In fact, this rack comes completely out if you wanted to. So that's pretty nice. A nice little feature to help mounting, especially in these half-height cases where you don't have a whole lot of space. What we're going to do now is we're going to get our motherboard out, mount the CPU. But prior to that, I'm going to try putting in a few drives here and see how that works out, or we'll figure it out. One thing with these smaller cases, in particular ITX, this is a micro ATX, is you really have to plan out your steps in a proper order. In some cases, really small ones, there is only maybe one or two procedural order that you can go in to build these things, and they can get quite frustrating. One thing with these cheaper cases is you have to watch for the very sharp edges. Lots of potential for cuts and injury there. But it is a nice case, and let's continue the build. Okay, I've mounted the hard drive, which mounts through the bottom holes. And now I have to do the optical drive to mount it. It as well mounts through screw through the bottom. And it's mounted like that through the bottom holes. So I'm going to get that done, and afterwards we are going to put the motherboard in. Get the processor on at first, get the motherboard in and lined up correctly, and then we shall continue on our way. With optical drives, I prefer to use all four screws, cut down on vibration and whatnot. I've opened up some systems in the past for repair or whatnot that had one screw in and a lot of vibration from the optical drive. I don't foresee this optical drive being used that much in this system, given what I had mentioned prior about streaming services and local content, but we're mounting it in there. I always like to give the option. Once it's in, and everything in a star pattern. Not too tight. And it's done. It'll slip right in into the system like this. Move forward. I have to take out the front plate, of course, before I do that. And then mount everything in, and everything should be fine. So, this assembly is ready for mounting. Now we're going to get the motherboard prepared. The MSI motherboard is small, even by micro ATX standard. ITX would probably be around here, cut off. So you only have around this much extra space, and it's quite a small board. But again, if you can look at the back panel, we have the HDMI, DVI, DVB, which we're not going to be using. We have the PS2 ports, legacy, we don't need those. Four USB 3s, two USB 2s. We have the gigabit Ethernet with the audio, which we won't really have to worry with too much because everything's going to be coming through HDMI. Once again, it does exactly what we want it to do, and this is what we're after. We're just going to mount the CPU. There we go. Let's drop it right in. Make sure it's firm. Everything's good. Don't use any too much force to do any of this, actually. Just let, and that's it. We have the stock Intel cooler, which we'll be using. I like to rotate the cooler, even though the Intel side is one way. I like to rotate it in such a way that the power cord, the fan, the cable will be out of the way. And that suits it perfectly, just like that. Remount it. Have it perfectly mounted. Now it's time to get the board in the case. With the motherboard in hand, we gently move it into place. I've moved all the wires away. I've also mounted the motherboard back plate. This one fits quite nicely. As you can see, with this case, there's tons of room left. That's for the optical drives and all the drive area. I've used cases that are at least a third less as large. But it's a nice open build for what it is. The motherboard size does contribute to the feeling of openness. Everything so far is going according to plan, so let's continue, shall we? Okay, now with the motherboard mounted successfully, we can put back in the hard drive and the optical drive, which are already mounted inside the caddy. Let's follow the guide here. In. As simple as that, it's in. There's no need to screw this in, there's nothing to hold it down. These rubber pads here will keep pressure on the top of the case and keep this in position. And now we can start wiring up the power. Let's give you a look at what's going on so far. Not too bad, not too shabby. Let's get started on this. This is the main 24 pin. This is the fan. Okay, power for the fan, so let's separate everything now. Separated and ready. And that's the auxiliary power for the board. As with most of my builds, I'm going to do it dirty from the beginning, meaning it's not going to look the nicest, but in the end it'll look fantastic. Twist this in such a way that it won't have a chance to get in the way of anything else. I like to put my fingers underneath. I don't want to stress the board too much by pushing it down. And this cable we won't need. We don't need the Molex connector since we have a SATA drive, so we're going to deal with that afterwards. And then don't need that. That's fine. I'm going to tie this up after and put it underneath. And there, at least preliminary wise, we have it wired up. And it still looks fairly clean. The wiring's out of the way, as long as it doesn't impede the motion of the exhaust fan, which we're going to have to route over here. There's the fan header on the board that we're going to use. So we'll, if it's long enough, we'll route it underneath the rest of the cables. That way I can keep it down from going all over the place. There. The system is now fully wired up. All we have to do is do a little cleanup, and then we're going to plug it into the Samsung monitor behind here and have a little power on test. So, see what happens. Okay, we've got everything pretty much wired up. System's very clean. We used a fan header over here so we didn't have to route the wire across. We moved the front panel audio cable, which was on this side. We moved it on this side of the 24 pin, which will naturally keep it from moving upwards. The area around the CPU is very clear. Everything looks like it's wired up correctly. The fans, no problem with blockage of the fans. And now we're going to plug it in for a power on test. So this is where the rubber meets the road. Okay, now that we have everything wired up, ready for power, this is the moment of truth. We're going to turn it on for the first time, and we're going to make sure that everything is working, at least with respect to power. Okay, we have liftoff, we have the fan spinning, and we have the monitor. Excellent. There we have it. Fantastic. The CPU is recognized correctly as a Celeron G1840, 2.8 gigahertz. Very good. Current DRAM size. DRAM frequency is 1333. I have to check exactly out. I thought it was 1600. I may have been mistaken, but it's a home theater PC. It's not going to be a massive difference. I'm going to check. Definitely it's 4 gigs of size. We have the CPU temp listed at 33 Celsius. And it's quite warm in this room. It's at least 26, 27, so it's not a big deal. And everything is set. Interesting that on an H81 board, we have overclock profile listed, but we're going to get into that a little bit later. We're not going to overclock this at all. So we have liftoff. So the next thing to do is to seal the system off, put the cover back on, and install an operating system, and start from there. So let's get that started. So far, so good. Show you it running. Yep, as I thought, the 80 millimeter fan is a little bit loud for my liking. And not really necessary in a system like this. The Celeron is a very power-friendly CPU. So what we're going to do is we're going to put either exchange this fan for a quieter one, or we're just going to put a resistor on it, an inline resistor, a fan resistor, to cut down the a bit. All right, let's get cracking. Let's get started. Okay, our build is finally complete. I think it's a really smart looking build. Cody is installed very well under Mint Linux 17.2. The system is quite responsive, and playback is excellent. The system is very quiet. It has a few nice touches. I like the clean face. You have the open doors, you have the extra USB ports, FireWire, and you have your audio ports. Just in case we have some DVDs, the DVD burner is installed and working great. Again, the system is very quiet, which we think here at Silicon Nubian is essential for a home theater PC. We don't want it to detract from your, you know, media consumption duties, and it should just sit there, look nice, and do the job. So all in all, it was a fantastic build. If there's anything negative to say about this build, the case, being a cheaper case, not enough attention has been paid to the sharp corners inside, the sharp edges. Be very careful when building. There are some, you know, potential for injury, of course, whether you're an experienced builder or not. Just got to be careful where you put your hands. It is a cramped space, being half height, but that is expected. We wanted to get something that was would be very unobtrusive in its look when functioning as a home theater PC. Once again, it is extremely quiet. We did have to tune down the 80 millimeter exhaust fan that's on the top. That did give a amount of noise that we were not comfortable with. So a little fan controller resistor on there, and it's dead quiet now. So all in all, fantastic build. We hope the client enjoys this. I'm sure they will. And tune in again. We have another home theater PC we will be building in the near future, as well as other hardware and software reviews, Linux distributions. I'll show you the tools that I use to make YouTube videos. We're getting some equipment in to get the lighting a little bit better and the sound and whatnot. But we're a growing channel. If you like what we're doing, please don't hesitate to give a thumbs up, or even better, subscribe and get us on that way. So once again, thanks for watching. This is the completed home theater PC build, running Linux Mint and running Kodi. And we hope you will join us again in the future for upcoming videos. Thanks again.